A very good evening.
Ma'am, 2 minutes to go, ma'am, 2 minutes
okay,
to go.
I'm good.
4:30.
We will initiate the proceedings. A very good evening to this eminent gathering of experts and educators. English Language Teachers Association of India seeks to empower educators across the country to ensure that the best in teaching learning practices are available to our students. So let's see in a glimpse what LDI does. Today is a very special day as we conduct the 23rd session of the LTI webinar series 2020 on constructing multiple choice questions. It is my proud privilege to introduce our expert resource person for the day, Dr. P.N. Ramani. Dr. P.N. Ramani is an ELT specialist, curriculum developer, and teacher trainer. With over 45 years of experience, he has authored several ELT course books and research papers. He has initiated and implemented curricular reforms in ELT in India and the Middle East, guided and evaluated research at the master's, MPhil, and doctoral levels in language education, and conducted workshops on topics related to teaching, learning, and evaluation of English language and literature. We are very fortunate to have an expert of his stature here to guide us into how to construct multiple choice questions, the need of the hour, so that our online teaching learning and the teaching learning process is very successful for the educators and students alike. Over to you, Dr. Ramani. Thank you for gracing us with your presence and with the knowledge that you're going to share with us.
Thank you, Priyanka, for your excellent introduction. I am pleased to be part of this webinar series, and I would like to share my experience of setting and evaluating multiple choice questions, not only related to English language teaching, but also in other subjects. But today's session, I'll focus mostly on examples taken from English language tests. As Priyanka said, the moderator said in her introduction, most students in most competitive examinations have to face multiple choice questions. So it depends on how well the multiple choice questions are designed. You know that every multiple choice question has a question, a stem, and four or five answers, choices, or options. You may call them options. Only one of them is the correct answer, and all the others are called distractors. They are meant to distract the attention of the test taker away from the correct answer by sounding more or less similar to the correct answer and making answering the question more challenging and difficult. Now, I'll begin by talking about two basic concepts in testing, language testing and any testing. Next slide. Okay. The first concept is called validity. You say that a test item is valid, a test is valid, if it actually tests what it intends to test. For example, if there is a multiple choice item on grammar, if it tests only that particular grammatical item, then it is a valid test. If your aim is to test the communicative ability of a learner, and you set 25 multiple choice questions on grammar and vocabulary, then that test will not be a valid test because you are only testing specific aspects of the language, not the real ability to use English in real life context. So that's the meaning of validity. It's the degree to which a test item or a test actually tests what it is intended to test. The other concept is reliability. If you have a set of 50 multiple choice items, and if you administer the same test to the same group of students at different time intervals, say 3 or 4 times, you should get the same results. The candidate should be able to answer the questions in the same way. If it doesn't happen, then the test is not a reliable test. I'm not going to technical details of these concepts in greater detail because these are not as simple as they sound or they appear to be. But for today's purpose, I'll only conclude by saying that a test which is not reliable in successive re-administrations cannot be a valid test. So this is the relationship between the two concepts, validity and reliability. The second one is A test can be reliable. A grammatical item, multiple choice item may be reliable if it produces the same score, same result, even after five or six different administrations. But it doesn't necessarily become a valid test if it doesn't test the particular grammatical item that it aimed to test in the first place. So with this very brief introduction to the basic concepts of testing, I'll move on to the next one. I would like all the participants to take a poll. Read the question very quickly. First poll, please, Sravan. I want you to answer this question. How would you complete this sentence? Which of the options would you choose? Right. Yeah, this gives me a fair indication of what is wrong with this test item. You see, there are people who have answered all the four. I mean, small percentage, 4% have answered the first one. They've chosen the first option. Majority of you have chosen the second option. And then 15%, the third option. Again, a limited percentage of people have opted for the last option, have not been away. So the choice is between B and D, okay? Have been away or have not been away. It is usual for multiple choice test designers to include among the distractors an option which is the opposite of the correct answer. So one of the two has to be correct. And most of the test takers will eliminate the other two. If there are two options and one is the conveys the meaning which is opposite to that of the other option, then the remaining two options are ruled out, eliminated at the outset. For example, options A and C will straight away be ruled out. And then there's only a question of B or D, have been away or have not been away. Again, why is the difference in the way people have responded to these items? Depending on the context, this stem doesn't give you enough context to be able to decide whether I feel like I have not been away for years, I've been away only for quite some time, a few seconds, a few hours, or I feel I have been away for years. You know the story of Rip Van Winkle, okay? So let me not go into the details. Let's move on to the next example. So if there are two items which are opposite in meaning to each other, one of them is the correct answer. The other two, which are equal in meaning, have similar meaning, will have to be ruled out right at the outset. Look at this. This is a sample question paper, question item from class 10 exam, public examination, maybe mock exam. Read the text very quickly and see what you will choose for A. This is not a poll question because you have to answer four questions based on this passage. Look at the first one. As a young boy, I was to play on the ground, are to play on the ground, used to play on the ground, had to play on the ground. So when you try to put each of these words in the blank, you realize that options 1 and 3 can be ruled out, eliminated right at the outset. You have a choice between used and had. Do you think only one of these two is correct? As a young boy, I used to play on the ground near my home, an activity which I regularly did, or I had to play on the ground near my home because I didn't have the time to go to a playground which was a little far away, something like that. So depending on the context in which I, as a test taker, interpret that sentence, I can choose either option 4 or option 2. So this is not a valid item because two answers are possible. B, at the far end of the ground was a library. At the near end of the ground was a library. At the off end of the ground, at the hind end of the ground. Do you think anyone would ever think of choosing either 3 or 4? I don't think so. The word hind is the odd man out in this among these choices, actually. So both 1 and 2 may be correct. If the library is at the near end of the ground, okay, could be true, or at the far end of the ground. Again, this item is not an effective multiple choice item. What about blank C? I'd often seen people walk in and out of it, carried books, carrying books, carries books, carry books. A clever person will say, I had often seen people walk in and out. So the tense of that verb is walk. I've seen them walk. So they may rule out carried or carries because people cannot be singular. They have to choose between 3 and 4. It's a possibility that, you know, some of them may choose 4, but the correct answer is 2, option 2. The last one, I walked in and politely asked the librarian, option B, option 2, him a book, 2 a book, options 2 and 4 will be eliminated right at the outset. The choice is between for a book and about a book. I think both of these options are correct answers because I could ask the librarian about a particular book. I don't know the details. I only say, remember the title or the author's name. Or if I knew the details, I would ask the librarian for a particular book. Both these options are correct. So you have an issue with every one of these 4 multiple choice items based on a very short paragraph. Maybe the test designer may have thought it was quite easy and there would not be any confusion. But as you can see, there could be a lot of confusion with regard to each one of these items. I would like to take a poll on this. Which one of these 4 options do you think is correct? So except for, people are still voting. Good. Options C and D have got lower percentage of respondents. Complaint and request. That majority of you have seemed to favor the option B, command. This is not an effective multiple choice item because, in my view, all the 4 options are correct answers. This is an utterance which is taken out of context. The test designer has to give more information about the context for test takers to be able to decide which is the correct answer. Sam, hey, give me back my phone. Hey, give me back my phone. Give me back my phone. I don't want you to tease me, okay? It can be complaint. Hey, give me back my phone, yeah. It can be a request. The context is not sufficiently clarified for the test takers to be able to make a clear choice among the 4 options. So the given utterance can be an accusation, command, complaint or request, depending on how you actually articulate it, how you make the utterance in a particular context, specific context. So when you ask questions like this on the function of a particular utterance, You know that the same structure can be used for different functions. The same function can be used to, same function can be expressed through more than one structure. So without proper context, you will not be able to decide which of these four options is correct. You may wonder why I'm only giving examples where there are problems in the distractors, the way multiple choice items are tested. If I were to describe how to construct a test item, then that would be more theoretical. So I thought of using actual examples of multiple choice items from board exams or mock exams given by established schools across the country to tell you what is problematic, which is of these. Shall we move on to the next sample? This is taken from a reading passage followed by comprehension questions, 5 multiple choice questions. But this is a question based on the vocabulary. The best way out of a bad situation is to remain calm when faced with a calamity. Choose the word that has the same meaning as calamity. Look at option B. What's wrong with that option? The other options, catastrophe, conservation, cataract, all these are nouns. They are in the same part of speech as the head word, calamity. But option B is an adjective in form, contiguous. When you give four options, all the four options should be of the same part of speech. So because it is an adjective, most test takers may eliminate that right away without even knowing what it means, with it trying to find out what it means. What about option C? Conservation. Conservation is a very common term. Conservation of energy, conservation of the environment, conservation of water, electricity, and so on. But here the sentence talks about when faced with such a calamity, remain calm. So conservation doesn't collocate with the rest of the sentence, so that can be ruled out easily. Cataract, most people associate cataract with the problem with the eyes, cataract. So what has it got to do with this sentence? So clever students, even average students, would be able to zoom in on the correct choice, even if they don't know the meaning of catastrophe. Another point that I would like to highlight about vocabulary questions is that the purpose of this item, vocabulary question, is to find out whether the test takers know the meaning of the head word. Your aim is not to find out whether they know the meaning of all these options, all the alternatives given. The test is not to find out whether they know all the four words and what each word means. The ability to know the meaning of the head word calamity, and then which is the word that comes closest to that in meaning, they have to choose. So don't make a multiple choice item in vocabulary more difficult than necessary by including words which might be difficult for the learners, for the test takers, as distractors. This is a piece of suggestion. I'll come back at the end of the session. I'll give you a list of do's and don'ts based on these examples and the discussion. This question is obviously based on an item in pronunciation, checking whether students can pronounce these words correctly, especially the vowel sounds. Some test designers may leave out that bit of instruction. They'll simply say which two words are the odd ones out. But the cue is consider the vowel sounds. Land, male, tail, rain, beak. Without being able to pronounce the three words which have the same vowel sound correctly as they should be pronounced, the test takers can eliminate beak and land. Even if they pronounce the word fail as fail, or male as male, rain as rain. So successfully answering questions like this with regard to pronunciation doesn't guarantee that the test takers have a very good command of the pronunciation of the three words that you test, or even all the five words that you are included among the options. There are other ways of testing pronunciation through multiple choice items. I may not have time to go through those details, because in one session you cannot exhaust all the different ways in which multiple choice items have to be set in grammar and vocabulary and pronunciation, in reading comprehension, and so on. Let me move on to the next one. So far, I've shown you samples related to grammar, vocabulary, and pronunciation, discrete items. Now we'll move on to reading comprehension, multiple choice items. This is a favorite. In most reading passages, people set multiple choice questions. What I've done is, I'm not going to display on the screen the whole passage, because it's pretty long. It has about 650 odd words. I've taken three or four extracts from that long passage, but I've included all the five questions which were set on the whole passage. And I'm going to show how, by only processing these short extracts from the longer passage, one can answer all the five questions. Of course, there'll be some problems, issues with the multiple choice items themselves. We'll look at them as we go along. This is an extract taken from the first passage. I think you need to take a poll on this. Yes. Let me look at the poll results. Right. So the first option, then the percentage is going up. For the third option, there's only 4%. What's that? Tend to make one careless. Yeah. Make one over trusting. Make them suspicious of strangers. Okay. Majority of you have got the correct answer. Correct answer is one. The point is, if you matched keywords from the stem with same or similar words from the passage, you get the answer almost immediately. Okay, these handy exchanges match these expression with strangers while traveling. Smart and upper person. So these handy exchanges, the previous part of the sentence refers to strangers. Smartening upper person is the correct answer. It's much easier. Even if you don't have to process this entire text of 60 words, you simply scan the text and find the same words in both the text, both the stem and the passage, and then you get the correct answer. But still, why did some people opt for option 2 and 4? Make them suspicious of strangers. They might have got this answer by basing, by going back to their own experience. Okay, when you meet strangers in different countries, different parts of the world, then you get to suspect those strangers. You don't easily get carried away. Sometimes you may have been, taken for a ride by some of these strangers. So based on that expression, you must have jumped on to option B as a possible answer. So 14%. And 10% of people have opted for option 4, which could also be based on one's own experience, makes one over-trusting of strangers. By the way, the strangers talk to you. They appear to help you in difficult situations and so on. Okay. Look at the next sample from the same passage. There were two multiple choice questions based on the same extract. The travel blogger had a bad experience. It's not very difficult. It's not at all difficult to choose the correct answer. The answer is in Rome. Because the very first sentence of this extract says, I was only invited by a local in Rome. So this is an exercise in scanning. You scan for specific words, specific details, specific information, and you match the word with one of the options there. And you easily get the correct answer. Even this extract is only 56 words long, but even without going through all the 56 words, your eyes zoom in on the word Rome, and then one of the choices has the word Rome, and then you choose the correct answer. Look at the next one on the same extract. I've reproduced the same extract. Again, this is the problem of matching the keywords in the stem in the question with the words, similar words in the passage. Hindsight, we have words in the sentence, hindsight, travel blogger, because this is about a travel blogger beginning. Taught, the word taught me acceptance. So which is the correct answer? Option B, acceptance. Not anger management, compassion, or patience, but acceptance. These few samples have shown that when you construct a multiple choice item, you should not try to use the same words from the passage. You should try to reword them, the sentence, the stem, or the options should be a rewording, a rephrasing of the corresponding section or part of the reading passage given. If it's a word-for-word reproduction, then it makes things very easy for test takers to choose the correct answer without making any effort at all. Extract 3 from the same passage. Travel makes one realize. First line, when you travel, you realize that people all over the world are not very different, although they may do things differently. As I showed with one of the earlier examples, there are two options here. One is the opposite of the other. Option 1 are very different around the world. Option 3 are not very different. As I told you, only one of the two is correct. Okay, because one is the opposite of the other. Both cannot be correct. Only one of them is correct. And by reading the first line, you know that option 3 is the correct answer, not option 1. Ironically, in the evaluation scheme, the marking scheme given for this reading comprehension questions, the correct answer given was option 1. not three. So the answer scheme was wrong. Answer key was wrong. What about options two and four? They love to exchange notes. They have the same ambitions. There's nothing in the whole passage that talks about ambitions and things like that. Okay. So again, matching keywords, making answering this question very easy. Look at this. Travel helps one get rid of. Travel thus helps you to get rid of race, religion, and cultural stereotypes. Correct answer is option four, obviously. Now, look at the options. You have the expression, the phrase in the stem, get rid of. What are the other words that can collocate with this? What can you get rid of? Can you get rid of the fear of traveling? Yes, you can get rid of a fear. Can you get rid of lavish spending on travel? Is it possible to get rid of spending? No. Can you get rid of travel being a monster? Get rid of the fear of travel being a monster. Okay. So each of these options requires slight rewording in addition to not verbatim reproducing the words from the passage in the options. Now, the four extracts I took from the passage one. The passage one, you may remember, I said is 657 words long. If we add up the number of words of these four extracts, it comes to 120 words. By processing less than 20% of the text, if your students can answer all the five multiple choice questions set on the passage, then it's not an effective test of reading comprehension. They don't have to read through other paragraphs at all. Whole chunks of the passage can be left unread for answering the questions. They don't need to. So you are not actually testing reading comprehension. There are interesting details in the other paragraphs because I'm not showing you the entire passage. I will not be able to exemplify them. But you could set very interesting multiple choice questions, more challenging questions based on the other sections of the passage which I have left out. Okay. This is another from taken from another passage from 12, from class 10. The first passage was from class 12. This is about Yogeshwar Dutt, the freestyle wrestler. Okay. A quality necessary for a champion is, read the passage. Yogeshwar Dutt's story is one of passion for the sport and his perseverance and solid determination in realizing his dream. Yogeshwar has qualities of a champion and virtues like humility, respect for others, etc., etc. Which of these is the correct answer? The test designer obviously expects option four to be chosen, each one of the above. This is a kind of mistake or trap test designers of multiple choice items have to avoid. Don't use options like all of the above, none of the above, or each of the above, some of the above. In fact, some people, when they consult you to set multiple choice items, they make it a part of their instruction to the test designers, item creators, avoid these choices. You cannot use this. So this is confusing. The first sentence talks about his life, you know, his qualities, personal qualities, but they don't say that these are the qualities necessary for a champion. Just because he possesses these, you cannot infer from this that Yogeshwar became a champion because he had these qualities. All the people who have these three qualities need not be champions in Olympic competitions. Okay, so it raises several issues relating to the question itself. Look at this. He wanted to participate in more and more competitions, but he was pulled down. Look at this stem. Yogeshwar Dutt lost almost a year in 2009 because of scanning. 2009, pulled down by injuries in 2009, that robbed him of nearly 1 year. So which of the options is correct? The first one, injuries. What about loss of weight? After that, he could not reduce his weight too often. Okay. The polling is going on. Sorry, I forgot that I had given it as a poll question. Yeah, 89% have obviously chosen injuries. Okay. 0% worship and 1% villages. I'm happy that this result has come out. Some students might have been distracted by the second part of the extract, but even there, he could not reduce his weight too often. But the option says loss of weight. That's a contradiction. But okay, this is a reasonably good distractor. Okay, but what about worship and villages? How could an Olympic champion lose 1 year because of worship? What has worship got to do with losing a year of training? How are the villagers responsible for Yogeshwar Dutt losing 1 year? So these two options were simply thrown in as an afterthought, I suppose, and one can very easily eliminate them. Nobody will even turn to these options as even the remote possibility. I'm happy that the poll results have proved my point. The last one. Stand in the desert, near them on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies. This is obviously an extract from a poem which was taught on the course. And then three multiple choice items were set on this. Okay. Now, none of the above, I've already said you have to avoid that option. Okay. And then the sculptor and Shelley was the poet. Shelley could not be buried in the sand, you know, stand in the desert on the sand, half sunk. Okay, the sculptor. So Shelley, the poet, cannot be referred to in these lines. But some people who have not read this poem or who missed these classes might have chosen this. Okay. But the sculptor could be an option. My objection to this item is none of the above. None of the above. Look at question B. The face expresses poll. What is the answer to B on this? Look at the way the poll results fluctuate. Only about 3% have opted for love as the correct answer. And 17% calmness, 28% indifference, 51% anger. It's not anger, but look at this phrase, sneer of cold command. People who chose the option anger might have been misled by the word frown, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command. It's more of indifference to people around him. And especially because this poem was taught on the course, most students should be able to remember that Ozymandias was not angry with people around him, but he didn't respect them at all. He looked down upon everybody around him. Okay? He looked with contempt on everybody around him. So indifference would be the correct answer, but anger is a good distractor. But love, there is no word there. It says frown, wrinkled, sneer, cold. None of these are just love. So how can you include that as an option? And calmness again. Though calmness is slightly different from love, but it is on the same scale. Okay, love and calmness. The person who is being described cannot be given these attributes, calmness and love. So two options get eliminated right at the outset, and students have to choose only between the other two. Now, I suppose you remember the various examples that I displayed and the polls you took, the answers you chose, and in the discussion I pointed out what was wrong with each of those multiple choice items. To sum up, the main points related to constructing multiple choice items would be this. I'm not saying that these are the only tips that you need to remember, but this will go a long way in helping you to design multiple choice items more effectively. Okay. Avoid using the opposite of the correct answer as one of the distractors. We have already seen two examples in which this happened. And in one example, the grammar item, the first item that you took the poll in, both these were possible correct answers. I feel that I have not been away for years. I have been away for years. So there, the purpose was lost. Avoid incorrect items that have the same or similar meanings. Going back to the same first item, has been away and had been away. Okay, these two have same meanings, but then if two incorrect items are the same or similar meanings, then they are bound to be ruled out. Okay, two items with similar meanings will be treated as incorrect, so people will not attempt to choose between those two items. Make the alternatives easy to understand. This goes back to the example of the vocabulary item, calamity. It's a head word, the content of the reading passage, and the meaning of that head word in the reading passage that is being tested, not the ability to understand the alternatives. In our eagerness to impress the test takers or make it very challenging for the test takers, we include among the options words which are more difficult than the head word itself. So if they are unfamiliar, either you make the students give up in frustration or make a guess of the correct answer, their answers will not reflect whether they have understood the meaning of the word or not. Make sure that you provide only one right answer. In many of the instructions given to test creators, item creators of multiple choice items, people will say, don't create ambiguous items. This is the meaning of ambiguity. More than one meaning, more than one option is plausible as the correct answer. Then you'll have complaint from the test takers at a later point of time. You'll be in for a lot of criticism. It's not a valid item. Every item should have only one correct answer. Present utterances in context. This goes back to the utterance, you know, Sam, hey, give me back my phone. It may be difficult to decide which of the possible functions is intended by an utterance unless you provide the context of the utterance slightly clearer by means of a prefatory statement or one sentence, two sentence context in which it is said. You may think that providing a context will make it easy for students to answer their question, choose the correct answer, but there are ways of making the context slightly clearer without giving the answer away. The correct answer should not come directly from the reading passage. It should be reworded or rephrased. We have looked at many examples where the words used in the stem were the words taken directly from the passage. So there was no challenge at all. It would make the test taker's job very easy, simply to match the keywords and get the correct answer. The other alternative should be clearly incorrect, but it doesn't mean they should not be logical. They should be logical. That is, people from their own background, knowledge, and experience should not rule it out. For example, if one of the options is the sun rose in the west, then obviously it is not a correct answer. Okay. So do not include illogical answers as incorrect answers, alternatives in multiple choice items. This should be based on a possible misunderstanding of the text. In the passage, in the extract from Ozymandias, the sneer command and the word frown. So some people were distracted by the word frown and they thought that the emotion represented was anger rather than indifference. So possible misunderstanding of the text. By choosing a few words or parts of the text which are not directly relevant, but basing your answers on those parts of the text, not understanding the text correctly. The alternative should be nearly the same length. The correct alternative should not be much longer or much shorter than the others. I don't think I gave any example of that. Maybe in one case, one of the two answers, which are opposites of each other, one was slightly longer. But in some cases, no. The clear difference in the length of the alternatives will be a cue, will be a giveaway for the test takers to choose the correct answer. Now, that happens especially when you set questions on one-word substitution or meaning of an idiom or phrase, an idiomatic expression, and things like that. Do not put the correct alternative predominantly in the middle of the alternatives. What I mean is, many test takers, I'll rush through this because I think I've almost used up my time. Either B or C, if there are four choices. If there are five choices, they give the correct answer as option C. You have to vary. Okay. Again, it doesn't have to be ABCD, ABCD, or DCBA, DCBA. In some research, it was found out that people who took the TOEFL exam, okay, reading comprehension test in TOEFL, without reading the passage, they simply marked ABCD, ABCD in that sequence for all the questions, and they got 33% of the answers correct. They happen to be correct answers. It's not a guesswork. Blindly marking A, B, C, D in that sequence. Okay. Don't ask questions that require information from outside of the text or that can be answered based on one's general knowledge. Invariably, when there are passages on Mahatma Gandhi or Jawaharlal Nehru or some of the celebrities or sports personalities and so on, sometimes you ask questions which may be answered from based on general knowledge, not necessarily by going through the passage. It's not a test of reading comprehension. In that case, you have to make clear as part of the instruction that all the questions should be answered only based on the information given in the passage. That should be an extra bit of instruction to the reading comprehension test. We have already talked about this. Next one, avoid statements with the last one. Avoid alternatives such as all of the above, none of the above, each of the above. And also avoid statements with words like always or never. You know, the adverbs of frequency are on a continuum. You cannot clearly have a demarcation between always one extreme, never another extreme. Between the two, there are words like occasionally, seldom, rarely, frequently, and so on. So avoid this because this makes the stem difficult. The content is one and whether it is always or never, the degree of frequency, the level of frequency will also be influencing the understanding of the text. I think that's all for now. I'll be able to be happy to answer questions if there are questions based on my input. I think there is still time for questions. Moderator, I'm sorry that I took a few more minutes than I intended to.
Thank you so much, sir, for that extremely informative, engaging and knowledgeable session for all of us. And we have a question for you.
Yes.
It is being asked by Mr. T.H. Lawrence. Mm-hmm. Why not direct the candidates to mark the most suitable option?
I've often seen these as an escape route. Okay. To saying choose the correct option. Which is the most suitable alternative or the best alternative may vary from person to person. Especially if the question requires making inferences based on the information given in the passage, not factual information. Factual information is either it's correct or it's wrong. Instead of 2009, you cannot say 2008. Okay, it's obviously wrong. Sometimes it helps to word the direction like this, choose the best alternative, the best option. In some competitive exams, I've seen this, but it's better to avoid that. The bottom line will be, there should be only one correct answer. It's not a question of degrees of correctness. One answer may appear to be more correct than another option. If at least two options appear to be correct, and you have to break your head about which is more correct than the other. One is 75% correct, another is, or 50% and 40%, 45%. So you're not giving a test in, you know, solving a puzzle, okay? So don't make it a puzzle question. That will be my response to that, yeah.
Yeah, that's very, very informative and very decision-making for us here. So we have Jayaprakash AA who has the question. In the question on finding the synonym of calamity, couldn't have been danger a better option than catastrophe? The answer option appears to be more difficult than the question.
Yeah, that was the point I was trying to make.
Precisely.
So are you testing the understanding of the meaning of the word calamity or the meaning of every word given as alternatives? So many students may not know the meaning of catastrophe. So because they don't know the meaning of catastrophe, they might choose one of the other options, okay? That may know, but they might know the meaning of calamity. They could have guessed the meaning of calamity from the passage, but because they are not sure of the meaning of catastrophe, they wouldn't like to choose that as the correct option. Okay. So they will skip that question. Some of them may skip the question because contiguous is adjective form, and conservation and cataract may not seem to be this. Even if they choose catastrophe as the correct answer, they might have done it purely based on guess, not because they know the meaning of the word catastrophe. You're right. Yeah. The idea is not to test their knowledge of all the four words that are given as alternatives, but the meaning of the head word. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, sir, it does. So we have one more question for you from Venkata Ramana.
Yeah.
Maybe know why not give all the above as answer?
Again, this is an escape route. I use the term distractor for the alternatives which are not correct. Okay. It's very difficult to construct a multiple choice item. It may be easy to construct a multiple choice item with only three options. But there, the probability of getting the correct answer is, you know, 1/3, 33.3%. If you give four options to choose from, again, there is a possibility of 25% answers, I mean, the answers being correct, okay? But it reduces the possibility of getting the correct answer. to devise three distractors along with one correct answer is difficult. It's not easy. Not all teachers can design multiple choice items. They need special training in designing multiple choice items. Please remember that. Just because it's a common pattern, you know, in the question paper, common type of question in the question paper pattern, it doesn't mean anybody can set multiple choice items. Even people like me know who have designed thousands of multiple choice items. When our own items go for review, the reviewers point out possibility of an error that among one of the errors that I mentioned today in my own presentation. So it's quite difficult. Nobody can set a perfectly correct multiple choice item. It's either impossible or very difficult, extremely challenging. And if you look at some of the standardized exams in the US, you'll have multiple choice items, you know, reading comprehension questions with five options. Not only four, but five. And even educational testing service, ETS, which conducts TOEFL, every year they conduct research analysis of the answers, and then they evaluate how effective each of the items is, and they make changes, they modify it, they publish their research findings. It's a very difficult area. I've only given you certain common tips so that you can avoid the common problems, but it doesn't guarantee that you can set perfect multiple choice item. Yes.
So we have one last question here. In most competitive exam, the option none of the above is frequently seen. Is there any set rules for making multiple choice questions? This is again, sir, what you just spoke about, the competitive exams.
Yeah. It is standard practice not to include that as one of the options. None of the above, each of the above, all of the above should be avoided as an option.
Okay.
Say in a TOEFL examination, for example, or any other competitive exam, even CAT exam for management, you know, admission test, you have to answer comprehension questions on four reading passages. Each passage is pretty long. And you have five comprehension questions, you know, multiple choice questions on each passage. You are given only 30 minutes time or 20 minutes time in which to answer 20 questions or 25 questions. So it's not easy for anyone to read, even to make a quick reading of each passage, even once. They have to depend on test-taking strategies, how to eliminate at least two of the four options right away, and then choose between the two by going back only to that part of the text which might contain the correct information. Okay. So that is a test-taking strategy without having to read through the entire passage. If you give all of the above, then they have to eliminate each of these. I mean, they have to make sure that every one of the other options is applicable. Okay. The person will not be able to complete the passage, which is not a recommended strategy to include. Some competitors may use it, but I'm against it. Personally, I'm against including that as an option.
Again, a very valuable guideline, sir, over here. And with this, we would like to invite Susai, sir, here for the vote of thanks before we come to the closure and we sum up. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
It gives me immense pleasure to propose a word of thanks on this occasion. As all things come to an end, so is this webinar on constructing multiple choice questions, the 23rd webinar organized by the English Language Teachers Association of India. First, I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to the speaker of the day, Dr. P. N. Ramani, for his instructive session on constructing multiple choice questions, which I am sure is the need of the hour. The candidates in almost all competitive exams are tested through MCQs. It is Benjamin Franklin who once said, "Tell me, I forget. Teach me, I remember. Involve me, I learn." Thank you so much for making us involved in your session and enlightening us on how to construct MCQs by citing relevant examples.
It's my pleasure.
I'm sure.
Yes, sir.
I'm sure our teachers must have understood how to construct MCQs and how not to make errors while constructing multiple choice questions. I take this opportunity to thank the LTI's organizing committee and the chapter heads and members of Delhi West and Thiruvaru chapters for their coordination and support in making this webinar a grand success. Finally, my sincere heartfelt gratitude to all the attendees for taking their time to attend this webinar, which I'm sure must have made an impact. Thank you once again. A couple of quick announcements before we wind up. Please note that our next webinar will be on 11th October 2020, titled Dynamics of Teaching English Online. Get yourselves registered and make use of this opportunity. Feedback form for this webinar will not be shared, but will be sent to all the attendees who have attended this session fully. You will be receiving your certificate of attendance in a week's time if you have attended today's whole session. So thank you once again, and looking forward to meeting you soon in our next session.
Before we bid adieu, I'd like to sum up the session that we had today. Thank you, Susai sir, for that vote of thanks. I'd like to sum up the session for today, where we learned tremendously from reliability and validity to discrete MCQs, to designing MCQs to look at the head word and the stem so that it does justice to the learners or the test takers here. Dr. Ramani, you have made today's Sunday evening a very, very enjoyable learning exercise for all of us. And looking at the chat box and the enthusiasm coming from the learners, the co-learners in the journey, so we've all learned tremendously. And we will look forward to more such sessions coming to us from LTI so that we are able to empower ourselves. Thank you, all the educators who've joined us today, and your heartfelt participation, which has made today's session an extremely, extremely enriching one for all of us. Thank you once again, and bye-bye to you.